As one of the world's most successful nonfiction China writers, Peter Hessler reviews his recipe for good nonfiction writing.
I often spend months or even years with somebody that I'm writing about. My hope is that by knowing this person very well, I become sympathetic to him or her, and that comes through in my writing.
Having lived in China for over a decade, how does he compare China with his home country?
The Chinese view of their culture and their history is somewhat equivalent to the U.S. view of democracy and freedom and their political. I mean, these are things that make them very proud. It's central to their identity.
Hessler has also seen how the Chinese people have opened their minds and changed how they view the world outside their borders.
When Chinese people look at the outside world now, this generation, they tend to see opportunity.
You've summarized the American national characteristics as pride, ambition, impatience, the instinct to control, and the desire to accumulate, and also the missionary impulse. Do you think, you know, some of them are similar to that, those of the Chinese?
I think some of them are. I mean, I think that certainly the ambition and the pride, you know, these are both big countries that have a very strong sense of themselves. But there's some differences. I think that missionary impulse that Americans have is a little different than what the Chinese have. And I think when the Americans see the outside world, the instinct often is they want what we have. They want to be like us. You know, we can help them become more like us. And I think sometimes the Chinese instinct is a little more, they don't understand us. You know, we're too complicated, or, you know, they don't really get what we're doing. And I think both of those ideas can be flawed, basically. I mean, and I think it causes problems for each country, these mindsets.
Problems like misunderstanding?
Well, I think in the U.S., I mean, certainly since 9/11, I think we see the policies where, you know, where I think the over-aggressive foreign policy, basically, you know, and being too optimistic about, you know, you go into Iraq and you think that you can solve a problem very quickly, and it really takes longer. And I think with the Chinese, this weakness for many years, I mean, you look at everything after the revolution and how many years it took for China to finally start to engage with the outside world. I think that's because of this instinct, oh, we're different, they can't really understand us, or they don't treat us well, and you know.
Peter Hessler has spent over a decade living in and reporting China before he moved his family to Egypt. His China trilogy, River Tan, Oracle Bones, and Country Driving has been met with great success. China View recently met with Hessler in Beijing, where he came to promote his essay collection, Strange Stones.
And you've also said Americans are storytellers, you know, they are more self-expressive, but that is not the, you know, usually that is not the case in China, where people do not want to put themselves in the center of things. And does that make your reporting here in China more difficult?
Yeah, certainly. I mean, I think it's, especially when you're in the countryside or when you're dealing with older people or more traditional people, it's a challenge. You know, I think people are not as eager to talk as they are in America. In America, you meet somebody and often they'll tell you very personal things very quickly. I think with the younger generation, that's probably changing now. And, you know, there's more individualism in China, and I think people are, you know, it's easier to talk to the younger people about their lives.
We may be shy from, you know, self-expression, but we never, you know, seldom hesitate to glorify our culture, our own country. And what do you think of the need to glorify, you know, our own culture?
I mean, I always felt like the Chinese view of their culture and their history is somewhat equivalent to the U.S. view of democracy and freedom and their political. I mean, these are things that make them very proud and central to their identity. These are not natural countries. You know, you look at America, you have all of these immigrants from all over the world who've come there, very different people. And you look at China, and it's not really one race of people. You know, these are many different groups, many different languages. So you have to have these ideas that unify. And I think in the States, the idea is this political system, and that we have freedom, we have democracy, we have something special. And I think in China, this idea is, you know, history and culture. We're Chinese. This is special. And in a way, these are very effective things. I mean, they do hold these. These are very coherent countries.
Mm-hmm. And you seem a little bit disappointed about Americans' lack of interest in the outside world, mm-hmm. as is shown in Strange Stones. Is that so?
Yeah, no, I think this is a tough period for America. I mean, I think And I think it's not surprising. You know, when a country undergoes a very traumatic encounter with the outside world, they often respond in negative ways. And I think after 9/11, you know, at the moment 9/11 happened, basically, I had a strong feeling that the American foreign policy was going to be somewhat flawed and destructive, because it's a pattern. We see this everywhere. Look at China after the Opium Wars. You know, look at how long it took for China to recover from that trauma. When I look at China, one thing that makes me optimistic is that when Chinese people look at the outside world now, this generation, they tend to see opportunity. You know, and yes, that's a good thing. It's a positive thing. I feel like Americans right now, when they look at the outside world, they tend to see a threat. You know, and I think they have to get past that.
Hessler was sent to China in 1996 by the Peace Corps. He spent 2 years in the country teaching English. The college he taught at is in a small city called Fulin, located near the Yangtze River in southwest China.
As a former English teacher in southwest China, what do you think of the educational system here? And, you know, where the repetition is highly appreciated.
I mean, most of my students were coming from the countryside, and their job was to return to the countryside to teach. And so I had a lot of contact with rural schools in pretty poor areas at that time. And I feel like China has been pretty remarkably successful at getting education at those lowest levels. I think the higher levels, though, the more sophisticated education, that's a challenge. That's the next step. You know, and I think they still haven't figured that out. And as you mentioned, the repetition, I always thought that's a problem with education. And I think the emphasis on sort of group thinking and doing the same things as everybody else. I mean, I feel like there is a current of individualism in Chinese society, and the education system is lagging behind that current, I feel like. You know, I just was always, from the time I was a child, I was somebody who didn't like to work in groups. I liked to do my own thing. I was pretty creative, and they gave me enough space to do that, you know, and I feel like in a Chinese school, it's hard to do that.
If stands out too much, then you'll be isolated.
Yeah.
Or you feel too different from everybody else.
Yeah, and there's all this bureaucracy in a classroom. You know, you go into a classroom and they have the class monitor, and they have another kid who's a hygiene monitor, and it's sort of like teaching kids to be little bureaucrats, you know, sometimes they have kids criticize each other, and those kind of dynamics I'm not positive about, you know, and I think some of that stuff can change.
And one thing amazing about your books is that you touch upon political topics without directly writing them. So how did you make that?
Well, I think in China, it's a natural thing. I mean, to be honest, right now I'm writing about Egypt, and the politics is very direct, actually, because in Egypt there's a huge amount of direct politics. We've seen a lot of major change. When I lived in China, politics sort of affected people indirectly. You know, they weren't directly engaged. It wasn't the main topic on their minds, and so you had to get at it in an indirect way. And so I felt like that approach was appropriate to China. It wouldn't be appropriate to Egypt right now. So, you know, as a writer, you change your approach depending on where you are and what sort of challenge you see there.
Hessler became a staff writer for The New Yorker in 2000. He was the magazine's China correspondent until 2007.
You never tried to portray yourself as China expert, but just, you know, one of the foreigners in China who are trying to figure things out. Do you think that are one of the reasons, you know, and that makes your book both popular in and out of China?
I'm not sure, but I mean, to me, that's a natural stance, because, you know, I feel like as a journalist, I can understand very specific things. And so when I would write about a factory, I would try to learn as much about that factory. If I wrote about a farmer, I'd try to learn as much about that person as I could. But I understand that that doesn't represent everything in China, and you don't want to make too much out of it. And I think this is such a huge, complicated country, and you need all kinds of viewpoints and all kinds of voices. And so I think you need all different kinds of writers, basically, to get the full picture of China. So you're never going to say, you know, this is the person who understands China. Nobody else understands. Only a foreigner can understand, or only a Chinese can understand. We need all of these people working on this.
And have you found yourself, you know, in this moral conflict of taking part of somebody's life and put it on the page?
Yeah, I mean, it's a challenge of being a writer. My feeling is, when I invest time in getting to know somebody, I often spend months or even years with somebody that I'm writing about. my hope is that by knowing this person very well, I become sympathetic to him or her, and that that comes through in my writing, you know. And but I do, you know, I feel a sense of responsibility when I write.
In Leslie's book, one of her interviewees said, and she's a migrant, you know, she said that home is nice, but you can only stay for a few days. Mm-hmm. I think that is also true for you, both you and Leslie, you know, you're always moving around. Mm-hmm. And what does home mean to you?
Yeah, I mean, it's somewhat fluid. I mean, I feel like as a writer, it's useful to change your perspective, basically. And my pattern now is every 5 or 6 years to go to a different place, basically. And I think just to stay fresh, you know, and to make sure that I'm not getting too accustomed to something, I think it helps you remain observant. But we do have a home in Colorado. We go back there every summer. It's a gift to be able to live in different places. You know, I think if you're comfortable doing that, then you have so many more opportunities and life becomes so much richer.
Although Hessler's China coverage proved to be a great success, he wasn't satisfied with confining himself to the country. After leaving China in 2007, Hessler moved to Southwest Colorado for a few years before moving to Cairo in the fall of 2011.
What do you think of the future of both China and Egypt?
I'm more optimistic about the future here in China, to be honest. I mean, Egypt is a tough period right now. There's been a lot of violence. People are very disappointed in the revolution. Sort of at the local level, at the street level, people tend to treat each other quite well. If you're an outsider, they treat you quite well. And so it hasn't become totally chaotic. And I sort of feel like Egypt will continue to remain basically fine in that sense. But at the same time, the interesting thing is that in Egypt, that kind of kindness that I see on the street has not translated into political kindness. Mm-hmm. Look at the incredible, incredibly vicious battles, you know, for political supremacy. I mean, you know, once the Muslim Brotherhood was overthrown, Morsi, who was president, is in a cage on trial. You know, it's brutal. You know, and I don't see a real positive change in people's thinking. You know, in China, I see a lot of challenges as well. I mean, I think there's a lot of big problems in China, obviously, but I do feel like there also have been significant positive changes in people's thinking.
In terms of the ongoing reforms in China, did you expect it to be carried out to its current extent when you left China?
I mean, I think we still haven't seen any fundamental change.
By that, you mean?
I mean, there's been a change in leadership, but I'm talking about a change of system. I don't believe we've seen a fundamental change in system, you know, and so I think we've seen a lot of changes in the culture. I think we see a lot of changes in the thinking of people. I think that people's ideas change. But in terms of government structure and the way it operates, I don't really believe that we've had a radical change, you know.
According to your observation, do you think radical change is suitable for China?
I'm wary of radical change anywhere, you know, and I've seen it happen in Egypt, and it, you know, it hasn't been pretty there. And I think that it takes people time to get accustomed to changes, you know, and so I think when everything changes all at once, which is sort of what Americans tend to want, people don't respond well psychologically. And I feel like it made sense for the Chinese to begin with these economic changes and to begin with raising the living standard and the education level.